there yet?
Are we there yet?
Ah! Are we there yet?
No, but why aren't we there yet? I'm talking about electric vehicle adoption in America, or its slow pace. We are way behind other countries when it comes to ditching gas vehicles. On this Plugged In episode, I speak with four industry experts to find out why America hasn't yet put the pedal to the metal on EVs. The short answer? There's too much stigma against EVs, stemming from good old-fashioned propaganda, so let's debunk it. First, I want to clear something up. EVs are not some new groundbreaking technology. The first electric vehicles looked like this, and in the 19th century, they were simply called horseless carriages. Now, I could do a whole episode on EV history, and honestly, maybe I will. But for the sake of staying on track here, know that EVs have been around for over 140 years.
It blows my mind. It's crazy. An electric car from 1909.
They're actually even older than gas-powered cars. Yet here we are, in 2025, and all electric vehicles only make up about 9% of America's new car market share. If we include plug-in hybrid EVs, which can run on both gas and electricity, that number increases to a measly 9.7%. Now that's compared to nearly 90% of all electric vehicles in Norway, about 63% in Sweden, and around 30% in the UK and China. So the question is, why is America stuck in first gear? I know EVs don't have gears. I just can't resist a car bun.
My opinion is raw ignorance. I talk to so many people. I would never drive one. They're horrible. Don't they catch on fire? And like every time one of those is brought up, it's just this weird, I hate saying it, but it just strikes me as like propaganda by Chevron or Shell or, you know, the petroleum industry.
That's Johnny Lieberman. He's host of the popular YouTube show Driving with Johnny. And his answer touches on some EV myths that we'll get into. But I want to say that Johnny isn't the only person I spoke with who believes that big oil fuels EV misinformation. Nikki Gordon-Bloomfield, founder and host of Transport Evolved, shared a similar idea.
It's a combination, like this perfect storm of political misinformation, fossil fuel lobbying. Lobbyists in America are very, very powerful.
For the sake of time, I'm choosing not to go down a rabbit hole of big oil propaganda against EVs. You can watch the 2006 film Who Killed the Electric Car for that. But I will tell you that big oil spent over $7 million on anti-EV policy advertising in 2021 alone. And that's just one of the things we know about. So yes, there are a lot of misconceptions about EVs, likely fueled by corporations who stand to lose big if Americans do go electric.
It's all about the oil.
Let's talk about the top ones. EVs are way more expensive than gas cars. EVs run out of battery quickly and take too long to charge. EVs are dangerous or not actually good for the environment. And EVs aren't cool to drive. Okay, what qualifies as expensive is subjective, but these days, EVs really don't cost that much more than gas-powered cars. Tom Bowen from Qmerit, the leader in EV charger installation, says too expensive hasn't really been a strong argument since 2021.
We're seeing a number of models coming out that make EVs much more accessible. Price points are down, volume and types of selection of brands, et cetera, models are increased significantly.
General Motors and Ford have made billion-dollar investments in new assembly plants focused on more affordable EVs, including a new Chevy Bolt and a Ford truck starting at $30,000. Now, those are slated for 2027, but there are already similar price models out there. For example, one of the top-selling gas cars right now is the 2025 Chevrolet Equinox, with a starting price just under $30,000. Its twin, the Equinox EV, starts at just under $32,000. That's only a $2,000 difference. And considering the average new car price today is around $48,000, an EV for under $34,000, it's pretty price friendly.
I think that blows out the water the assertion that EVs are more expensive than gasoline cars.
Not to mention
two words, tax incentives.
You might still qualify for local, state, or even utility incentives for EVs or home chargers. Even if an EV sticker price is higher, we also need to consider the total cost of ownership. One study compared the lifetime cost of electric versus gas vehicles of similar sizes and models. It found that small and low-range EVs cost drivers less, while longer-range sedan and mid-size EVs cost about the same as their gas counterparts.
The break-even point in most countries on EVs now is 2 to 3 years.
And it's a small sample size, but all four experts I spoke with for this episode say they are saving money by driving electric.
The Rivian we have, zero maintenance. I mean, okay, I've probably spent $15 on windshield wiper fluid over the 3 years. That's it.
How many pickup truck owners can say that? There's also the potential fuel savings. And I say potential because, well, have you seen electricity prices lately? But State of Charge host Tom Malogny says you'll still see savings as long as you're mostly charging at home.
If you use public DC fast charging infrastructure, it's very comparable to gasoline, the cost. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I urge people to charge whenever they can at home.
Unless, of course, you have convenient access to free public chargers, which are pretty sweet. The bottom line here, though, the argument that EVs are far more expensive than gas-powered cars simply isn't true.
If you are able to charge at home, you are able to get a good overnight charge, you're going to save a lot of money. Obviously, tie that with a solar system, with a battery, you're going to be quids in if you can invest that money up front.
Okay, so we started with cost because money speaks to all of us. But the biggest concern from EV skeptics is actually range anxiety. Tom Bowen says that, too, is an outdated concern.
The initial adopters of these vehicles had ranges from 150 to 200 miles. And now you have some of these vehicles 300 to 400 mile range with a charge. That helps to eliminate a lot of anxiety.
If you are still worried that getting an EV will leave you stranded on the side of the road, Tom Malogny has this assignment for you.
Take a little pad and pen. And every day you get in your car, write down your starting mileage and your ending mileage. Do that for about 3 months. I've been telling people to do this for years. I can't tell you how many people came back and they're like, you know, I'm averaging like 30 miles a day and I'm worried about getting a car with 300 mile range.
The average North American driver travels 29 miles per day. But through this screen, I can hear some of you crying, but what if I like to take road trips?
Road trip!
I've done cross-country drives. Just a couple weeks ago, I went up into Canada by Niagara Falls. I don't worry about it. All the vehicles have different navigation systems, but nearly all the vehicles today that are sold route you to which are the best stops and would say, okay, you're going to drive 220 miles and stop here, and you're going to need to stop there for 32 minutes.
Now, of course, if you're road tripping to rural North Dakota, where there aren't a ton of public charging stations, an EV might not be the best choice for that trip.
It's very location dependent, but I just personally think if you're really not road tripping constantly, you know, if you go to visit your in-laws once a year, and you mostly just run around town, just get an EV.
But here's the thing that most people don't realize about EV charging. It's very different from getting gas. You don't drive to empty and then fill up. Most EV owners charge at home every single night.
We use the statistics at Qmerit that 80% of the charging will take place residentially.
It's kind of like charging your phone. Think about it. When was the last time your phone ran completely out of battery? Probably not very often because you charge it overnight. EVs work the same way.
It's never out of gas. We just charge it at home. I have an app on my phone, you know, right here. My Rivian is at 79%.
Now onto the second part of this myth, charging time.
Modern EVs do not take 10 hours to charge. Even one of the worst charging EVs on the market today, even in the absolute worst conditions, middle of winter, it's cold, about an hour to an hour and a half for a decent 80% charge.
Most of the EVs made today charge from 0 to 80% in less than 20 minutes. So if you are going on that road trip with an EV, here's what your pit stops will look like.
We plugged in, we both went to the bathroom, we bought like beef jerky and two bottles of water. And by the time we got back, it was charged to 85%.
Okay, this is the anti-EV argument that fires me up the most. Pun intended, because people believe that EVs are more prone to fires. And why is that?
There's 121,000 car fires a year in America, a year. How many that aren't EVs do you hear about? The answer is zero, because no one bothers to cover it.
In reality, a national study found that for every 100,000 EVs sold, only 25 catch fire. For gas cars, that number is over 1,500. Hybrid vehicles do see the most fires at nearly 3,500. And then there's this idea that EVs aren't actually good for the environment because mining the batteries is worse than oil extraction.
Complete, total fabrication. Nothing could be less true. You've never burned a gallon of gas in your life without using cobalt. You mine lithium once. Gasoline, you forever, constantly.
And how often do you have to get a new battery?
Batteries today are designed, engineered to last the lifetime of the vehicle.
Plus, there's the efficiency reality.
When you burn gasoline, 20% of the power or 20% of the energy in the gasoline is converted into forward momentum. The rest, 80%, is heat and noise. With an EV, 60% of the battery, of the energy in the battery, is used for forward momentum, and 40% is lost to heat and noise. However, because of regenerative braking, where you can like actually spin the motors backwards to put energy back into the battery, electric vehicles are able to recapture 20 to 30%. So they can be between 80 and 90% efficient.
That's 4 to 4.5 times more efficient. So even if you charge your EV entirely with electricity that was coming from a coal plant, which almost nobody does, it would still be cleaner than burning gasoline. All right, again, cool is subjective, but many Americans don't see EVs as cool to drive. Tesla was the brand that really broke the mold there, but then, well, they're not exactly the status symbol everyone wants to be associated with anymore. But for this episode, I talked to self-proclaimed car guys who were initially EV skeptics. I mean, Johnny literally drives sports cars for a living and chooses an electric pickup truck for his personal life.
I love a good sounding engine more than most people. That's kind of my passion in life is like supercars. I love them. Like, we just shot a Lamborghini Revuelto video for my YouTube channel, 1001 horsepower supercar. And to get the sustained 110 mile an hour tracking shot from another vehicle that was smooth, we used my pickup truck, my off-road tired pickup truck, because the Rivian can do it and it handles great.
Then there's Tom Malogny, who was driving a Porsche Boxster back in 2008 when he got his first electric Mini Cooper.
The Porsche was just sitting in the garage. And then I ended up selling it. So I think that's a testament to the fun to drive. That instant torque of an electric vehicle is exhilarating. If you're a car guy
or girl
and you drive an EV, it just puts a grin on your face.
Nearly two decades later, and he's driving the electric Ford F-150 Lightning.
Thing goes 0 to 60 in under 4 seconds.
That's fast.
It launches like a Chevrolet Corvette.
Tell me that's not cool. It seems everyone is a skeptic until they drive electric. Here's my favorite story from all of these interviews. Johnny was at a car club with a friend who was going off about how much he hated EVs. So Johnny told him to take a spin in his Rivian.
No, I have no interest. I go, would you go for a ride with me? Can I just take you on a ride? We drove around for 5 minutes and we came back and he just said, I want to buy your truck. Can I buy your truck off of you? I want to take it home with me.
5 minutes. That's all it took to change this guy's mind.
Experience them before you pass judgment on them, I guess would be my final word. People say a lot of things that aren't true.
There you have it. A lot of what you thought you knew about EVs isn't true. A big thanks here to Johnny, Nikki, Tom, and Tom for debunking EV myths with me in this episode. Though we ran out of time for answers to this one burning question. If you had to bet, when would EVs hit 50% of new car sales in America?
50% in the US? Boy,
that's a legit question.
And that's what we're talking about on part two of our EV series. What roadblocks do we need to pass for EVs to become mainstream in the US? Go ahead and hit subscribe so you don't miss that one. And in the meantime, go test drive an EV and stay plugged in.